So I was on faculty here for, we're probably a little hot on the mic. just saying.
Oh, I forgot to say he's vice president of Youth for Christ International. That's not your exact title.
Not really. It's not. Actually, more current, and I don't blame you, we haven't updated everything yet. But, so I was a senior vice president for Youth for Christ USA. And in the last year, have migrated upward or downward, I haven't figured it out yet, to senior ministry advisor. So still in the mix. What I like about it is it means I don't have lots of budgets and lots of people reporting to me. And I have an all access pass. What I'm not sure I like about it is nobody reporting to me. That makes sense. But it's for the best. We've actually, some of the people that were direct reports for me, about 35-year-old vice presidents now, and we sort of this was part of the grand plan to hand it off. This is not such a big room. I couldn't handle this without a mic, just in case you wanted to. So, hey, I'm so glad you started too by talking about saying goodbye, because I realized that I got issues of not really dealing with this room very well in the past. I mean, I was 22 years full-time faculty meetings, sitting somewhere in that region a lot of times. I'm not sure I've done my work and said goodbye yet, so can I get some private audience?
You want to do some work?
Yeah, in front of everyone.
Models and stuff?
You've always wanted that with me. It's really, really good to be with you. I look forward to this opportunity. Part of it is because of the journey that I'm on. And I'd like to go there right away. So the notion, gritty Sabbath rest, this concept is probably, this is the like inaugural moment for me to start to play out numbers of different presentations, including a really fun one that's on the calendar in early January at Yale, of all places. So I'm a part of a research project that I've been invited into at Yale, and it's including this moment where the assignment of Sabbath was given to me for adolescence and joy. And I don't know that they know exactly how I'm going to handle that, but this word gritty Sabbath rest has been in me, and we're going to launch a research project starting in January for 6 months in this direction, especially attentive to the young people that I feel like have captured my heart as a result of Youth for Christ. I'm especially intrigued. Youth for Christ is migrating with ferocity to the cities. Two-thirds of American kids 11 to 19 now live in the cities. Half of American kids aren't on church's radar screen in any way, shape, or form. It will be three-quarters of Americans' kids in the cities. We've got to be there. And that takes me into a whole different arena. Sort of chronic adversity is a reality for so many of those kids. We in our City Life programs we track with kids who log more than four of these childhood adversity indicators, four of the ten, which are great, as you might imagine. They're great. The research says that they're great predictors of poor outcomes at so many different levels in adulthood. And what I've been intrigued with is those that have come to Christ and sort of embed their lives in Christ, they find an overcoming strength that I think is really intriguing. We call them indigenous leaders. They're from the neighborhood. They serve in the neighborhood. They come back that way. And I think they're also a gold mine when it comes to research for all of us. Does that make sense? You know, if you can help a kid with that kind of background, and I say kid, they're probably in that 19 to 26-year-old range at this point, but with that kind of background, when you help them to establish something that's robust and, and it becomes a new storyline of their life. They got a backstory, but they got a, you know, the backstory isn't their future story, right? So their next story is about overcoming, and I think we all get to cherry pick and learn from them, and that's so it's some of the excitement for me. It's probably some of the passion of where I'm at in my life and pursuit right now. This is what you might have seen as a preamble for this particular lecture, but except for the last line. And the last line says, "Is my quest, my story." In many ways, it's very personal. It's very, I'm obsessing. This is the stuff that I wake up over sometimes in the middle of the night. And go, you know, I don't know how you handle that, by the way, but you know, because our brains do some really good work when we're sleeping, apparently. I go to bed and I, you know, just stuck on something, and all of a sudden in the middle of the night I go, whoa, where did that come from? And then, you know, after a half hour of, you know, trying to rearrange it in my head, I go, okay, I better get up and do something with this so I can go back to bed. But that's a lot of what seems like happens. It doesn't happen every night, thankfully, but it's a couple nights a week, it seems like. There's something I'm going to just go jot down and get after it. And I used to sort of anguish over that, not anymore. I think it's kind of cool. I don't know how it happens. I think Mark chapter 4 describes the farmer who goes out and throws the seed in the ground, and then he comes back and all by itself, he doesn't know how it happens, God makes it grow. And I think that there's something really significant about that. So, but the personal side of this has got to do with, you know, my family. And I, by the way, that's missing the latest too. We have another grandkid that came in April. And so this is as close as I got to a family picture that's somewhat current, and that's about 10 months ago. My son is directly to my left. My daughter is in the front right, my front right, I say that. And then now four grandkids. I put that in place in part because I think that the angst of some of what I've been working on, I could track all the way back to teaching undergrad here in the 90s. The angst of trying to figure out how to be the best I can be in all the particular responsibilities I've got. And I think this is a common human journey, and it certainly boils up significantly for anybody who's got leadership responsibilities. Because all that happens in the course of your life is you get more. More comes at you, more opportunities, right? And we get sort of richer if you're into the accumulation, but we run up against some things that are really troubling. I can concretely remember teaching an undergrad class, and we were working in Stephen Covey territory, first things first, and I was just unpacking for the students the dilemma of a journey when you feel a call from God to do something with a particular gift set. So let's just say that I felt like the Lord was asking me to raise my game as a speaker and teacher. Well, how do you do that? I mean, there's a lot of coaching and stuff that goes on, but the bottom line is you need a lot of experience. Hit the road. The only thing worse might be if you're a comic or something like that. You had to work a lot of small clubs and Starbucks lines and things like that. Just, you know, hey, did you hear the one about? No, it's all right. So I know, okay, there's a burden there. I've got to start to go out a bit. But it was the same time that my kids were really young, and I was eager. Especially, I wasn't raised in a church home. Some of you are probably like that. I came to faith in Christ as a high school sophomore in Peoria, Illinois, and did not know that I was not a Christian. I was just a clueless guy, and because I was an American, and it's a Christian country. So that's how I made my sense of this, and I would have voted for God, especially this year, I would have voted for God. Please, God. But you just, I just didn't know what I didn't know. And so coming to put faith in Christ just changed everything for me my last couple years of high school. And by the time I was done of being a pretty clueless, you know, young Christian. You know, I followed my buddy to Huntington College because, as far as I know, that was the only Christian college in the world, because that's where he was going, that's what he's supposed to do, right? So, and I didn't know how to get trained for what I now was getting excited about, and that was leading friends to Christ. I saw 18 of my friends my senior year come to Christ. Some of that was just part of my journey, and I got just immersed there. But not being raised in a Christian home puts you at a bit of a disadvantage, I think, when you're trying to be a dad, wonder what that looks like as a Christ follower. And so I was eager, and still am, to be a great father, a great husband, but I don't have the access to a great, you know, model that I grew up with in that direction. I kind of have access to a model of what I don't want to be like, which is not unhelpful, just not all the way helpful. So what I've concluded is, well, I know one thing, I got to spend a lot of time with my kids. And there it is. So now I'm choosing between two good things, right? I got to, hey, how do I get to be a great speaker like God wants me to be? You got to spend a lot of time on the road. Well, how do I get to be a great dad? You got to spend a lot of time with your kids. Well, wait a minute. That doesn't look like it's the kind of thing that's going to lend itself very easily to getting out a yellow pad and drawing a line of pros and cons. It just doesn't. It just felt like I was not going to get help from typical decision-making matrices, and it really wasn't until I just kind of threw myself on the ground, Lord, I don't know how to do this, and He finally said, "You ought to do it." Exactly. Thank you. Thank you. Now I've got your attention. Let's go. Let's go. And so this is a journey that started actually from then. And I'd like to take you with me on that journey. It's a journey that pivots around an absolutely crucial reality that, frankly, we don't sit in enough. We don't let bathe over our hearts, our minds, our souls enough. It's the simple reality that Jesus Christ is alive. It's the reality that possessed the early church to do amazing things. That we are not necessarily possessed by, and I want to take you down some of that journey a bit today, because I think there are ways that I've observed it in every ministry setting that I've been a part of, whether it's been church or connected to the college or Youth for Christ and parachurch organizations. I've had some access the last couple of years to speaking to something called the Youth Ministry Executive Council, a group of people who are leaders in youth ministry organizations, and boy, I push on this button and everybody's just, ew, boy. It, you know, they're shaking their head, they don't want to shake their head, that kind of thing. The reality is Jesus is alive. The reality is if Christ not been raised, then everything else that we do is useless. All of us who are sort of hovering around faith-based issues, everything else is useless. Not kind of okay. Not a value of 4 on a 10-point scale. You know, just reckoning with that. It was an easy message for the early church because of their experience with Jesus. It was, he's alive. Holy cow, he's alive. He is alive. And that changes everything. It still changes things. That's the advantage that, you know, I've had a lifeline to kids who are like me and then some. You know, clueless, unaware of God and His love for them. Oftentimes fatherless, you know, on and on it goes. And I've had a lifeline to those kids and their journeys. And I say that because of the way it's tethered me to a reality that's very, very important for my own soul. Okay, so 2 years ago, I wrote this book. And those who were handling me, and that's what happens when you're my age, you get handled. There's some scripture in John 21, right? Where Jesus tells Peter, when you get old, you're going to be led where you don't want to go. That's where I am right now. So, So those, they were talking about, you, we want you to write a book, and we want it to be an electronic book, and just trust us, you know, it'll serve our purposes. So, you know, connected with Youth for Christ, serving purposes of Youth for Christ, there is this book that somehow is in space, and you can access it for free if you want. It's at symmetryseries.com, symmetryseries.com. But inside that book, I worked at and have continued to work at the notion of our capacity and leveraging our limited human capacity for the glory of God. So when I talk about fixing broken patterns for kids in crisis, I'm not talking about kids' patterns. I'm talking about my patterns and your patterns, because we don't get our patterns fixed. Kids in crisis are in trouble. As Kenda Dean said in her book, Almost Christian, speaking of the research that Christian Smith has done for the National Study of Youth and Religion, where it is revealed how inarticulate young people are about their faith. Well, guess what? They learned it from somebody. It's either parents or church that they've learned how to be inarticulate. And that's some of my quest. There's patterns of living with Jesus, living around Jesus, living in the midst of what it means to be a Christian, that frankly have contributed to what I think is the malformation of a whole lot of people. So let me do a quick tour here, because and I got to be careful, because this is too intriguing for me, and I get excited about what I mean. I just, the capacity limitations to me are somewhat self-evident, and that's where I started. Then I discovered that, you know, they are also housed very conveniently inside four verses in Genesis chapter 2, and that's a significant chapter because it's really the only chapter where there are human beings before sin enters the world. So it's a kind of a go-to place in terms of our collective human state, human condition. So right away, Genesis 2:15, we see that God gives Adam an assignment about how to spend his time, and that's how I imagine it. You know, they're kind of just strolling the garden quite a bit, and sooner or later, Adam just goes, well, so, you know, is this it? Is this what you want? Here, this. And they also got, you know, hey, the clock's ticking. I mean, time is in play, right? How to spend my time. And God responds, well, why don't you take care of the garden? Here's your assignment. Take care of the garden. Can you imagine living life without any assignment, without any direction, without any purpose? I'm guessing that in many cases, some of you who are getting into this counseling arena, you bump into people who are just wandering and lost on this very agenda. And I think one of the coolest things about our human condition that I want to say to you is that we are all limited in our capacity of time. We don't get more time or less time. But inside of that, there is the potential of a meaningful assignment from the God of the universe. So there's hope and capacity reality. So over here, I'm going to put the reality right now. This is the big old capacity reality. You and I don't get more time than anybody else. Let's live with that. And connected to that, I think, are the two related issues. So one, I call just what goes on in my head, my thoughts, my choices, my judgments. You know, you probably run into the fact that they expose the fact that multitasking is a myth. You can't really do it. We don't have that capacity intellectually. What we can do really quick is stop and start and pivot and turn around and you know, pay attention to lots of different things. I like to just throw this out. I haven't necessarily read this anywhere. It just makes sense to me. If it makes sense to you, then chew on it for a while and see what I think the fruit of every thought is a choice. And the cop out there is, even if it's the choice to keep thinking about that or stop thinking about it. That there is, in fact, a choice, which takes me to the capacity in the garden again, right? So you can eat from any tree except this one tree. And therein Adam has been given the choice. He's endowed with choice, opportunity. It's a human capacity. It didn't begin after sin, it began in creation. Everybody's got choice capacity. What we don't have is unlimited choice capacity. We don't have unlimited ability to think about everything all at once. Now, we live in an amazing time in history, don't we? Earl Palmer wrote a great commentary on the book of Romans, and he talked about, especially Romans chapter 1 and 2, it's this image that I just want to, that Romans 1 and 2 describes a spiraling downward of human race as a result of sin. It just spirals downward and downward and downward. If that's true, we ought to be able to see that empirically in our world. And the storyline for many in the world, because of the amazing scientific, technological kind of progress that's taken place, is sort of just the opposite. They're going to point to other kind of indicators. But I'm thinking, this is sneaky Satan territory here. I can only think about so many things at once, and in my lifetime, I have seen more stuff come at me than I can possibly handle, right? We have more access than ever before because of technology. The problem is we haven't changed our capacity. So access only burdens us more. It creates flexibility. Choice is still there, but now I'm not making simple choices. Not like an agrarian culture where you kind of were just, and by the way, I live 90 minutes north of here in Amish country. I get the chance to, you know, just reflect on, I probably drove by more horses this morning than I would have seen in Kentucky bluegrass country. Just, you know, just normal way of life. Sometimes it looks like just a scene of a Hannibal farm. You know, the horses are talking to each other about overthrowing the people. So that's the second capacity limitation. The third capacity limitation is one of relationships. It's not good for man to be alone, was said in the garden. And what I've tried to represent there is my little grid to understand the research from Dunbar, Robin Dunbar, Oxford anthropologist, who discovered or has postulated, and it's been researched, it seems like, very strongly about our relationship capacity that's built into the neocortex part of our brain. And so we have a capacity of 150 friends, and then we have a capacity for 50, you know, good friends and 15 close friends and 5 intimate friends inside that. And that's the pattern. So it's 150 total, right? Youth for Christ just participated in a sample research from Fuller Youth, from Fuller, not Youth Institute, but Fuller, where they were basically trying to figure out if those of us who are wired with relational ministry as our background, do these numbers hold true? And the interesting news is, well, the numbers hold true in a collective. It doesn't mean that the configurations are right. So they found that instead of 15, our Youth for Christ staff might be wanting to have like an average of 29. Instead of 50, we were at 80. But then as a result of that, instead of 150, we're around 120. So it's not like you could, you know, just unlimitedly grow. You're just borrowing, right? And what they observed is your thinking as Youth for Christ staff, because you value relationships so much, as you think that But only the closest relationships are the ones that are more transformational. That's your stewardship, to get closer with kids, to bring them in closer to you. And as a result of that, you're working hard to pull more people into those inner circles and stranger in the other way. And by the way, the other thing they found is when you were 17 or more, you're a candidate for burnout. Okay, so we're kind of got a DEFCON red alert thing going in Youth for Christ right now on this. But here's what's fascinating to me. Jesus emptied himself. Right? Philippians chapter 2. The Greek word kenosis is a rich word. He emptied himself as the rights to the rights of God and became human being. And I want to suggest to you that that meant he also was bound by time. One thought at a time, and relational capacity. By the way, his numbers, there's 120 in the upper room. He sent out 70. He's got a dozen that are close and three that had intimate all access. Feels like a good pattern to me. I can only spend my time so many places, so here's my strategy for the reconciliation of all of the world. Throughout all of history, I'm going to call some people into my life in ways that I can handle and we can transform everything. It's pretty cool. So I come away not discouraged by capacity. I'm just actually encouraged that I have an awareness about what my limitations are. What's the gain? Now that I know what the current realities are, I get to make some adjustments. And now that I know that Jesus is in this with me, I get to make those adjustments in a more significant way too. I mean, one thing, I represent this small circle and say, well, you know, so doing this life with capacity with Jesus, maybe I'm really effective or faithful in that journey with my time or my thoughts for a certain percentage. And I don't do that, by the way, in the relationships, because I think there's a directionality of relationships as opposed to, you know, so it's like, of the 15 people in my life who are my most intimate and supportive people, my friendships, how many of them help me go the direction I want to go with the Lord? That's a storyline that I am really intrigued with kids who were gangbangers yesterday and met Jesus today. Because that's a big deal in their journey. If nobody is in that top, you know, the closest of the closest, I don't suspect it's going to go easy for them. But grow in the capacity, you know, grow. More of my life, more of my time, more of my thoughts centered on Christ. And now we're going to sneak up on this notion of, this is, I don't even know why I put that in there. Okay, sure. So like, I know that I'm not three people. That's what I meant to do here. So what I am is I'm this bundle of people, and then I want more of my life to be tethered to more of Jesus. And I want that for really important reasons. I think that I'm going to take you down that second journey. So here's a second book now I want to commend to you. It's a pretty recent book. It's just full of some sweet research on the notion of grit by psychologists from University of Pennsylvania, Dr. Angela Duckworth. And what I've been thinking about in this space is my effort. So capacity is the reality I've got to deal with. What do I do with about my effort? How do I up my game? What's on my table? What can I do? Now, you should know this is the bane of my wiring too. To think about what I can do right away. That's always been my. Everybody's got a little limp in their giddy up. That's mine. What can I do? What can I do? What can I do? Duckworth's theory is that talent times effort equals skill, and skill times effort equals achievement. Therefore, effort counts twice. And when she started to dig into the notion of effort, that's where she comes up with the word grit. Okay? Effort counts twice. What kind of effort? How do you understand the effort? How do you measure the effort? She was drawn into this because she had some sweet research assignments, one of which was West Point. You know, a whole bunch of folks entering into West Point, In the summer before they matriculate, they go through something called the Beast, which is a sort of high-intense training program that sort of washed some people out. People were failing. And as you can imagine, our military folks wanted to understand why. What's going on here? Because in a sense, there was equality in talent. So they met the thresholds of entry for West Point. They were sort of the same that way. So that wasn't the story. And it really got into this notion of grit. And Duckworth created a grit scale. So grit, in essence, is passion plus perseverance. Let me just unpack as quickly as I can. Passion, by the way, I hope I just teased you with the book. I hope that you want to just go dig out the book and think about things that's all about. Passion plus perseverance. Passion, starts with interest. Perhaps at the earliest age, if you're trying to be developmental on this, it might start middle school at the earliest. And, you know, you start to become aware of a direction, a directionality, and you know, at best, that direction can be vague. It's sort of, I want to go sort of westish, you know. It's very different than saying I want to head on US 24 west or something. But it moves into this sense of calling and greater purpose. Greater purpose being then almost a unifying theme of life. So what's fun for me is I look back and probably since the mid-90s, I feel like I've had two bosses career-wise. It's been Youth for Christ and Huntington College, Huntington University now. But, you know, both of them had some say. So in the early days, I had two job descriptions, I had two different paychecks. Pretty soon we started going, okay, let's negotiate this so that I got one boss so that we can talk a little bit more holistically about this. But, you know, for a long time, YFC was paying Huntington for some of my time, then Huntington started paying YFC for some of my time, and it's sort of balancing that up. But what was hanging it all together was something that wasn't exactly Youth for Christ, it wasn't exactly Huntington. It was my passion, my sense of calling, what I felt like God had created me to do, what he put me on the planet for. And it just keeps getting tighter and tighter and tighter. And it's just a blast. It is what gets you excited in the morning. It probably is what wakes you up in the middle of the night. And then there's perseverance. So specifically, it's endurance more than intensity. Habits come into play here. So the study of habits has been some of what I've been doing this summer, trying to make sure I could, you know, what's it look like to teach habits that make sense for kids who, you know, maybe don't have anything but bad habits that they didn't learn as a result of sort of desiring to focus on that. Notice this phrase, deliberate practice, because that comes up in the research too. Deliberate practice. Deliberate practice, Michael Phelps would engage in deliberate practice. And it had been 10,000 hours plus of that. So deliberate practice means after my workout, I'm going to pay attention to the thing that needs attention, and I'm going to redesign my stretch goals and my practice goals around that which needs most attention. If you can't concentrate on Jesus because you've got a lot of lusty stuff going on in your head, then deliberate practice means you're going to try to actually address the lusty stuff in your head. You're going to put it in play. You're going to notice things about your journey. You're going to notice, for example, man, it just seems like I'm a better person in the morning than I am in the evening. I wonder if that's connected to the fact that I actually start my day with scripture and coffee. Yeah. And I end my day on Facebook or watching TV or whatever. I wonder if there's just sort of a leakage through the day. Then you might be drawn to think about people like Daniel who had prayed multiple times. And, you know, there's value. And so deliberate practice actually makes us a student of our own heart and our own soul. That self-awareness that Jerry talked about, so crucial for anybody in leadership. So crucial for us as we sit before the Lord. By the way, if you sit before the Lord open-handed, and you're not yet self-aware, but you are open-handed and open-hearted, you'll get self-aware. You'll get tutored. The Lord will take you there. Open up those places. Fortunately, he says in Matthew chapter 11, I'm gentle and humble of heart. I always wonder about that. You know, that's if you're going to coach me in life and how to have this relationship with you that's restful, why that credential set? Why not say, this is true, because I made you, Dave. I knew you before you were formed in your mother's womb. I put you together perfectly. I know you better than you know yourself. That's why I can tutor you. But that's not what he says. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden. He says, for I am gentle. And I think, well, why? And then I realize what he's going to mess with. Those are my raw nerve endings right there. This is not small stuff he's gonna tinker with in my heart, my soul. He's gonna get after stuff that I've been holding on to sometimes and clutching on to. He's gonna mess with that. It's for my good. It's because I'm so bent and still corrupted by sin. I am working out my salvation with fear and trembling. I could use humble and gentle. And all-knowing, by the way. The notion of effort took me to some scripture here about effort. And there's a Greek word that makes me think, okay, well, a lot of effort in scripture attaches itself to this word sarx, flesh and sinful nature. And it's kind of a bad thing then, right? So the Spirit alone gives eternal life, Jesus said. Human effort accomplishes nothing. The very words I have spoken to you are spirit and life. Paul writes to the Galatians, how foolish can you be after starting your Christian lives in the spirit? Why are you now trying to become perfect by your own human effort? Paul writes in Philippians, we rely on what Christ Jesus has done for us. We put no confidence in human effort, though I could have confidence in my own effort if anyone could. There is something about effort that's to be, it's a frightening pathway. I, as a student of Dave Rahn, I recognize that I have loved and actually been paid very well, in my opinion, for my ability to use effort to deliver results for people. I'm not under any illusion about the good Christian organizations and the godly people who hired me produce. There's a part of me that wants to help them fix that. On the other hand, I don't begrudge them of that. It's a journey. It is a journey. But I would say this, at least it's formational. That is to say, who I am is in part because of the way I've related all these many years to Christian organizations. I brought that to the table. I got daddy issues. I had to work on that. I got daddy issues. You know, what's it going to look like to please Dad? Hey, maybe a little bit more effort, right? A little bit more. I'll bet he's impressed with this, right? We all got something we bring to the table in that regard of effort. And what disappoints me is how Christian leaders, in the name of the mission of their organization, trust me, in the name of the mission of their organization, elevating that organizational contribution to the kingdom of God, perhaps above all else, don't necessarily pay attention to my heart. I don't hold them responsible. Proverbs 4:23 says, above all else, guard your heart, for it's the wellspring of life. Everybody's journey is not my journey. When I made the move in 07 to leave Huntington full-time to go to YFC full-time, the deal breaker for me was that verse and the recognition that somehow in the joy of this journey and this place and this academic, just the whole academic milieu, I wasn't liking the direction of my heart. And I thought, this is not incremental. This is flea territory. And just moving just a little closer to the action, if you will, getting a chance to be, you know, the first day on the job, it was July 1. I was a head leader, we call it, at a middle school camp in Indiana. I had managed in my entire youth ministry career to avoid ever doing middle school camp until then. Just sort of left in that high school and beyond kind of age group, and there I was in middle school country. And listen, the whole camp was built, it felt like it was built for middle school size people. So right away I'm looking at the bunk bed that I'm in, and I'm going, okay, that's going on the floor. So now I'm getting, you know, it's very, you know, undignified. I'm getting stepped over all the time, you know, as I'm trying to lay down and sleep. And then I get, this true story, I go into the shower, this little shower that we've got in this place. And the novel hits me here. It's a box. It's like the tightest box I'd ever seen. If I lean to the right, I hit the wall this way, just right there. I hit the wall. I'm a large guy, right? You know, the world screams at you sometimes. You're a freak of nature. And that's, so there I am in the shower, and I'm thinking, man, this is going to be hard and stuff like that. And so I'm trying to get, you know, showered, getting all cleaned off, and I drop the soap. I try to get the soap up my leg a little bit with my foot, just to, and then I felt like I could hear laughter in heaven. I felt like, welcome to heart guarding. You know, and I, you know, walk out. There's a middle school kid in that camp who's impressed that I have a PhD. Right? Not one of them. Not one of them. Really good for my heart. I had to do calisthenics a little, stretch out more. There's also another word in Greek as you move through, and this one is translated. It's spude. That's the root word. It never quite shows up exactly like that. With haste, enthusiasm, earnestness, diligence. It's the one that's used at the beginning of one of my favorite passages in Scripture about spiritual formation, 2 Peter chapter 1. Make every effort, therefore, to add to your faith goodness. And the NIV says, add to your goodness knowledge, to your knowledge self-control, to the self-control, perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness love. And then it says this is probably the appeal side, for if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, A, I like the awareness that it's possible to sort of know Christ and be unfruitful. But that there's a growth journey here that I am supposed to make every effort to apply myself to. Okay, so there's that. The same word shows up in Ephesians 4:3. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. So it's not like I don't have effort in the game. And now grit is really intriguing to me. Because I want to see if there's something about grit that helps me understand the kind of effort that I want to apply. And by the way, I get grit, and I know the research of grit is about achievement. That's what drove Duckworth to do this, is the high achievers. But is there such a thing as grit in relationship? Is there such a thing as grit applied in my relationship with Jesus? And that takes me to one of my favorite words in a book that I've been still feasting on since I read it a little over a year ago, probably. The book by Sky Jathani, editor of Leadership Journal, called With. With. And I'm going to try to give you a quick overview of that book and sort of land a plane here in this lecture. So, notice he's going to lead us to the notion that we want to have our life with God. But before that, he makes the observation about the different bent or crooked ways, maybe as a result of sin and us not getting it, that we lean into our faith. So, and he sees this, and by the way, I've seen every one of these myself in observation and portions of this in my own life. So life under God. Think of the Pharisees there. Obeying God ensures he'll act like I want. I want the detail. If you're in that category, when you read scripture, you're drawn to the lists. You want those expectations. Clear. You want to know exactly what it is. And if you're a Pharisee, you want to know, you know, how do I keep the Sabbath? How much walking is too much walk on the Sabbath? And you get the rules, and the rules get rules, they beget rules. So knowing and following the rules, being obedient, and God, by the way, that word obedient in Scripture is in Scripture. So it's not like these are like left field issues. These are just couple degree course correction things that when they end up driving your life, they take you in a different direction. Life over God is one that sort of extracts from Scripture God's principles. So you put timeless truth, you read it. This is God as a clockmaker. He set it all in motion. Now let's learn and apply those truths. And you see this, by the way, all over the place. You see this in book titles, Jesus Christ CEO. You know, take the principles of Scripture and apply them to your life and they will work. This is the Dr. Phil approach to Christian faith that I, frankly, am desperately concerned about in the practice of youth ministry, because we try to coach behavior out of kids instead of taking them to Jesus and let them transform. What comes out of this is this, I mean, by the way, there's truth there. That's one of the things why it is appealing. There's truth about biblical principles that can be put to work. And the word that you're attracted to there is that you're going to be effective. Life from God is a nod to our me-centeredness, our consumerism. And probably prosperity gospel would be the biggest thing. You know, that God's all about sort of putting his efforts towards me and my image and my happiness and my joy, which is one of those things that, you know, the distillation of the National Study of Youth and Religion is that there's a adolescent faith they call moralistic therapeutic deism. The therapeutic is about God gives me happiness. That's what that means. So God's all about my happiness. When I'm not happy, I'm going to go to God so he can help me be happy. That's what God's supposed to do. Come through my happiness. Ask for our desires to be granted. What's true in Scripture is that we're blessed. Seeking the blessing versus seeking God is a different thing. And then there's life for God. And I will confess to you that of the four that we're talking about right here, this is the one that I'm most predisposed to. This is the default state for me in my own heart. After all, I work youth for Christ, right? So there we go. Achieving for God ensures an outcome that I want. Do great things for a great God. Be fruitful. About 2009, I think we wrapped up a learning cohort I did with a bunch of urban ministers from Youth for Christ under the leadership of the DeVos Foundation, the DeVos Urban Leadership Initiative. And as we did our presentations about our own breakthrough plans, two-thirds of everybody referenced a profound book that we've gone through together and studied and talked about called Leadership and Self-Deception by the Arbinger Institute. And my takeaway from that book at a personal level was to recognize that I've got a default script working. And my script is basically like the Blues Brothers. I'm on a mission from God. Which on itself seems like, well, that's cool. Except that the way the script played out is, I don't know if you are. Or you, or you, or you. So that makes me, the way I relate to you, as saying, you're either going to help me, or you're an obstacle, or even worse, you don't matter. Wow. Nothing about that. I mean, I tried to make that work, but it didn't. It's just ugly. That's all it was. I mean, that's an ugly script. That makes me an ugly person. And I could think of ways that I've done that and engaged in people. It doesn't change, by the way, the capacity, right? But you can say you're sorry you can't help somebody in an authentic way. Versus, resenting them and thinking of them as less than they are in terms of the value image that they have in God's economy. Anyway, that mission from God is life for God. And then it just finally takes us to life with God, where we lovingly join God and trust Him for what I want. Trust Him. Notice, by the way, in every one of the other ones, it's about control and getting what I want. But life with God gives up control. Gets to the place where you look so honestly and clearly at who Jesus is and who God is, and you go, why would I want to wrest control from Jesus when He offers to take charge? Now, that's a question worth a half a day of bothering you. Just sit in the question. The first hour, you might come up with something interesting. The third hour, you're going to have to wipe the tears off your... it's just... it'll undo you. My friend Rick Lawrence says, I've been ruined by Jesus. I think that's what he means. Because then you don't want anything else. You don't want anything except to be with Him. Let's look at Sabbath on this. So if you're in one category, you're insistent about all the ways you're going to keep the Sabbath. This is a clear rule. By the way, it's not so clear in our culture. Our heads explode trying to figure out how to do this. What does it look like when your entire society isn't all going that direction? What are you supposed to do? And there's all kinds of variations on the rules and things like that, but that's the journey. If you're in that column, you're trying to get that thing right. You want to know exactly what you do to keep the Sabbath. That obsession over the rules is going to help somehow do that for you. And in your profession, chances are this is a really warm phrase here. The counselors among you, Sabbath ensures margin. We know that margin is important. And so what we're going to do, maybe, is counsel people for more margin. Find Sabbath because you need it. It's a principle that works. I'm going to just say this. That's not where we're going to go with this journey, because it's powerless in the great, grand economy of God. It's wise counsel that stops short of tapping in to the timeless power of the Lord Jesus Himself. Do I need margin? Yes. It's just not enough. Getting margin isn't enough. That seems like it's tweetable. Somebody get there, will you? So, now we celebrate in this category that Jesus' statement that man was not made for Sabbath, but Sabbath was made for man. And you can imagine a few people in the audience going, great, party on. Here we go. This is my time. And a couple of millennia later, you see us kind of sitting in front of the football games doing this. After all, Sabbath was made for me. This is my time. I need me time. I need that. truth to that. Oh, this is me. Sabbath is that necessary pull into pit stop because I got to change my tires because I blow out otherwise. I have to. I just have to. I hate it. I hate slowing down. But when you tell me that I can be more productive as a result of this, I'm all in. And I can win the race. Yeah, I can do that. I need to do mental contortions to Sabbath myself. That's how I have to be. That's the way I'm wired. None of those are good enough. I don't want to take any one of those storylines to urban kids who've just come to Christ, or those that work with urban kids who've just come to Christ, or my buddies who have worked with Youth for Christ for 40 years. And I don't want any, none of us. Portions of truth, not enough. Place is that Jesus is my Sabbath rest. He is my Sabbath rest. Where's my starting point? He's alive. He says, apart from me, you can do nothing. He offers to be the rest, and the Hebrews unpacks that wonderfully in chapters 3 and 4. He's our rest. He is our rest. Some of you are going, okay, now wait a minute. Now what happens to the fourth commandment in the day now? Yeah. It gets messed with. But not in the direction, like everything that Jesus said, not in the direction that lets us off the hook. And if anything, in the direction it goes, more, more. Just like the Sermon on the Mount. You've heard it said. You've heard it said. Don't be angry. Don't murder. Don't have sexual relations outside of marriage. If I say to you, okay. No, he says more. More pervasive, more about your heart, more about who you are, more thorough. And so this is where I'm going here. I'm thinking, well, there's something fascinating about this journey, this Sabbath rest journey. And here's how it hangs together for me in my life. This is how I make sense of it. And this is, again, early stage of the journey. So I invite you to come in and critique that. Think about it. Chew on it. Well, I put Jesus as my Sabbath rest. Now I start to make sense of those other sort of partial truth tendencies that left by themselves are misleading, but when they're anchored around Jesus as my Sabbath rest, they secure. So he leads me into obedience, and obedience is a big deal. He secures the margin that I need. He secures it. I'm not operating. Listen, one of the worst things that's happened in the past couple decades in youth ministry, I don't know when it started, was the WWJD bracelets. Because it reinforced the myth that Jesus isn't really alive. Like he's some sort of historical figure who left this body of truth. And when you say, what would Jesus do? If I said, what would Jerry do? And I said it in his presence. Isn't that a bit offensive to Jerry? And a little stupid on my part? Jerry, what would you do? That's a different thing. I feel, what would Jesus do? Jesus goes, I'm right here. Just ask, please. I am right with you. I am right here. I'm either alive or it's all in vain. So he secures the margin I need. How fun for me to talk to Jesus about margin. And some of you are wired this way, so I want to just encourage you. I want to give you permission to bring your plan to Jesus about your margin. It's okay. Just know that he's got this giant red marker. And he might just make some adjustments in your plan. Because that's the journey. When you throw yourself in with him, you find rest in him. He reminds me why I'm blessed. He achieves in me and through me what I cannot do on my own. Listen, I've got a music playlist that I run through in the morning. It's part of my routine for my own quiet time to engage the Lord. There's a couple songs that are clearly on the list because they have corrective value. So here's one from Amy Grant that's on this list. I'm just not gonna play the whole song, but it's in the achievement category. Category for my heart. I got one on I got a few here, but this one, these go into this. Reminds me why I am blessed. So I get just a little bit of a course correction for the entitlement sort of thinking that I might bring to the table, or sometimes I might have that pity party where I just go, I deserve more, I want more, and then I'm reminded about his faithfulness in the journey. But I need help staying at the center too, and this is probably my favorite go-to song, the St. Patrick's Breastplate. It's in the middle there, the sound of breast.
Of wind down.
there are more songs in the playlist. But I offer those as some small evidence of my own attempt in my own life to do some deliberate practice. And the deliberate practice is in the direction of a gritty, Sabbath, restful relationship with Jesus. Gritty because it's about, I persevere, I want to push on, I want to go through it. Brother Lawrence, who might be the patron saint of this very practice, wrote, when we are faithful to keep ourselves in his holy presence and set him always before us, this also begets in us a holy freedom. And if I may so speak, a familiarity with God, wherewith we ask, and that successfully the graces we stand in need of. In the end, by often repeating these acts, and that's the habits, right? They become habitual, and the presence of God is rendered, as it were, natural to us. And therein lies the outcome of gritty seven. Two ways to do anything. I hate that question usually, but not when I'm using it. Enjoy a vital union with Jesus, attentive to him in a real-time relationship, because he's alive, he loves us, and he wants to be one with us. And then there's every other way. And it will take deliberate practice, to me, north of 10,000 hours to get good at living with Jesus. These days, in Youth for Christ, we have the most robust strategic planning effort I've ever seen in my history with YFC. Partly because, 2 years ago, joining our team at the national level was a retired four-star admiral named Bruce Klingon. He's got a Wikipedia site. That's how sort of significant he is. He was the chief in charge of planning for Tommy Franks in the Afghan War. So he joined Youth for Christ not knowing anything about us until he kind of got intrigued. And now he's leading us in strategic planning. He sort of knows what he's doing. And he's taken us on just this rigorous road that frankly sometimes I chafe under because I don't want to be thinking about this so much. But instead of getting to my wine zone, I treat this like washing pots in the kitchen, as Brother Lawrence would. How do I do strategic planning with Jesus? How do I write these complex, multi-page action plans with Jesus? How do I be a Cubs fan with Jesus? Trust me. It's an earnest prayer. I see that, Steve, and I'm ignoring it. A particular person in the ninth letter in Brother Lawrence's, I caught this. She seems to me full of goodwill, but she would go faster than grace. One does not become holy all at once. 10,000 hours. Over 10 years. Or, by the way, you know how you can walk 10,000 hours with Jesus? If you happen to be one of the disciples, in Mark 3:14, he appointed the 12 that they should be with him and that they should preach the gospel. And now you start the clock ticking and you're awake for 100 hours a week with Jesus until he dies. Because over 2 years, 100 hours a week will get you to 10,000 hours. And then they don't know what to do because all they knew how to do was be with Jesus. And then Jesus delivers a great commission, the changing of the world. And he says at the end of that, and lo, I am with you always. And it turns out they actually had acquired the only expertise they needed to be with Jesus. And now they wait on him like he said to do until they receive power and ongoing presence that changes everything. I like that storyline. With Jesus, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in them, don't produce much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Everything else, Paul writes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I've discarded everything else, counting it all as I decided to give you a more accurate translation. So that I can gain Christ and become one with him.
everything else. Everything else drops into place. Therefore, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. Let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. We do this by fixating on Jesus, obsessing over Jesus, reaching out, making sure that he's with us. It's a good thing I practice that same, he's beneath me, above me, over me, right, left, on, front, down. He's just, yeah. Keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Greedy Sabbath rest with Jesus can be a catalytic keystone habit. It pries me from control issues. I say that, you know, I got control issues. If you've got control issues, well, you're not going to raise your hand. You've got control issues because I just told you to. So you got, you know who you are. But it optimizes my limited capacity, right? It optimizes my time and my thoughts and my relational capacity for joy and for faithfulness and for productivity. So let me just leave you with that question. So to me, it's a person question. It's a fun question to deliver no matter where you are in your state of following Jesus. Whatever your leadership responsibilities are, I have great confidence this is a worthy question. You have hesitations about abandoning yourself entirely to the greedy pursuit of living in faithful union with Jesus. You don't get extra credit for running faster than Jesus. That's for all of you who are wired like me. You high achiever types. It's a perfect pace. And he offers that to us. Let me pray for you. Thank you. And now I think we'll go to break, right? Yeah. That's my control issue. You can do what you want, whatever you want. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness. Thank you for being with me on the drive this morning, in the heart preparation, in the slide preparation, in the delivery. A couple things I said today that surprised me. That's fun. I pray for the way that you might use these thoughts. I pray that they might be fruitful, that your Holy Spirit would swiftly carry them to the place in people's hearts and their minds where they're most needed, and that you might bring benefit to us. And I love the joy of doing this with you. Thank you again. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks.